This is the story of Air France Flight 2510. Accidents happen when tons of things go wrong. In most cases, you just need one thing to go right in a sea of wrong for things to end on a happy note. That is exactly what happened on the 28th of March, 2012. On that day, an Air France Airbus A320 was making the flight from Paris, France to Hamburg, Germany with, we don't know how many people on board, information scarce. As the plane approached Hamburg, the airport was changing things up. Until that point, planes used runway 33 for both landings and takeoffs, but now runway 23 was the runway for landings and runway 33 was the runway for takeoffs. This was to account for a crosswind. You always want to land into the wind, as that makes things a lot easier. This meant some extra work for the flight crew. They had set up an approach onto runway 33, but now they had to reprogram the computers for the ILS approach onto runway 23. But that's not too hard. Soon they were lining up with the runway. Their plane had latched onto the localizer of runway 23 and they were number 2 to land. The day was windy. The pilots decided to go for a flap 3 landing instead of a full flap landing. That just meant that they wouldn't fully extend the flaps during the approach. They were 9 nautical miles from the runway. Their glide slope was alive and the pilots verified that they were where they were supposed to be using the DME beacon Alpha Lima Foxtrot. As all of this happened, an Air Berlin 737 that had landed earlier was taxiing around on the ground on its way to the terminal, but it had to hold short of runway 23 on taxiway Delta because flight 2510 was just about to land. In the cockpit of the A320, a small diamond moved to indicate that the plane was below the glide slope. But unknown to the crew, the plane was actually above the glide slope. In the next 30 seconds, this reading changed. The instruments now told the pilots that they were above the glide slope. The captain, in response, pulled power back and started descending at about 2,900 feet per minute to get back on the correct glide path. Satisfied with their efforts, the pilots stabilized the plane and extended the gears. Suddenly, their instruments told them that they're very, very low and nowhere near the glide path. The first officer suggests a go-around. It was no use salvaging this approach. The captain agreed. The captain pitched the plane up to carry out the go-around. He's rudely interrupted by his plane. The warning said, speed, 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 warning the pilots to pay attention to their speed. They were now at 143 knots. The throttles were advanced to the MCT, or maximum continuous thrust detent, but that wasn't enough. The plane's speed kept decaying. Soon, the plane was at 121 knots, which was dangerously low. This was serious. Suddenly, the engines roared to life, pushing the plane's speed up, and by extension, the plane out of danger. The pilots had to pitch the plane down a bit to keep the plane under control. The go-around went well after that. They got up to 4,000 feet, then stabilized their airplane, and then made a safe approach onto runway 33. The unknown number of people on board made it off without a scratch. They were probably unaware of how close they came to disaster. To understand what happened here, we must first look at the go-around itself. The pilots were approaching the runway, and suddenly the plane showed that they were dangerously below the glide slope. This prompted the first officer to suggest a go-around. At this point, the captain agrees with the first officer's assessment. It would not be safe, and he pulls back on the stick for a go-around. But he does not do one very important thing. He did not add power. The throttles were left at idle. This is what caused the plane's speed to drop and for the speed warning to come on. In reaction to this, the captain advanced the throttles to the MCT detent, or the maximum continuous thrust detent. MCT is the maximum amount of thrust that an engine can continuously provide, but that wasn't enough. For a go-around, you need every bit of power that your engines can give you. You are, after all, trying to change the direction of travel of this giant hunk of metal. That's where toga power comes in. No, it's not some power that ancient Romans believed in. It stands for takeoff/go-around power. In this setting, the engines give you all they've got, but this setting wasn't selected. The plane's speed continued to bleed off. The speed got all the way down to 121 knots. For an A320, that's low. Very low. Keep in mind they were flying a flap 3 approach, and that's supposed to be flown at a higher speed than a full flap landing. This plane was in a precarious position. The plane desperately needed power. Suddenly, the throttles were pushed to max power, and the plane was saved. You might think that it was the first officer who intervened. But no, It was the plane. The A320 has what's known as alpha floor protection. The plane's computers constantly monitor the plane and the state that it's in. It checks things like speed and angle of attack. Angle of attack is also known as alpha, by the way. In simple terms, it's the angle between the oncoming air and the wing. If the computer sees that the angle of attack is too big, or if the speed is too low, the computer will automatically engage the alpha floor mode and push the engines to toga power, thereby saving the plane. The computer is basically like, okay, you're in a sticky situation now, here's some additional power to help you through this. Researching this video, I came across an Airbus technical document from 1993. It's basically a document where Airbus goes, hey airlines, look at all this cool tech we have. I just want to quote a bit from that document. Quote, should the aircraft energy drop below a certain threshold, a low energy oral warning is triggered calling speed, speed. Should the aircraft angle of attack reach the threshold of alpha floor, the auto thrust sets toga thrust automatically. End quote. This was written in 1993, and it matches flight 2510 to the letter. What's even better is that the system worked as intended. They thought of everything, to be honest. They programmed it to save the plane in case the pilot made things worse. Good job, Airbus. Actually, things should not have gotten this bad. The first officer was supposed to monitor the instruments and let the captain know that he had not engaged toga mode. But the first officer was busy monitoring the speed and reprogramming the system that he just did not notice. The next thing we need to look at is how they got into a situation where they needed to carry out a go-around. They were established on the ILS. The ILS, or the instrument landing system, is a system of radio beacons that guides a plane right down to the foot of the runway on the correct glide path. They looked at the flight data and the glide slope that they should have flown. They weren't even flying a glide slope at the end. Their altitude was all over the place. Moreover, their instruments were lying to them. When you're established on an ILS approach, you have this little diamond that tells you where you are in relation to the glide slope. If the diamond is towards the bottom, it means that you're above the glide slope. If it's towards the top, you're below the glide slope. If it's in the center, you're good. At one point, the plane was well below the glide slope, and the indicator showed that they were on glide. At another point, they were really far off the glide slope, and the indicator showed that they were just below the glide slope. This is dangerous. If there was something wrong with the ILS beacon at Hamburg, it could guide a plane right into the ground. Talking to the controllers, they knew exactly what had happened. ILS antennas have what's known as a critical zone. It's this area around the antenna that should be kept free of objects when someone's using the ILS. If something is in the critical or sensitive zone, it can really mess with the signals emitted by the antenna, mess it up so much that a plane on approach might be sent off course. When this happens, the vertical guidance by the ILS is no longer accurate. A taxiway went right through the critical zone of the ILS antenna for runway 23. At Hamburg, if someone's on the ILS, you kept this area clear. But on the 28th of March, 2012, that did not happen. Remember that Air Berlin 737 that made an approach and was holding short of runway 23? Well, as it turned out, it was smack dab in the middle of this critical zone. Usually, controllers keep this area clear, as mentioned before. Well, the controller did try. The tower initially cleared the 737 to cross runway 23. But they taxied slower than usual, and so by the time they got to the point where they had to cross the runway that flight 2510 was landing on, it was too late and they had to wait for the plane to land. Usually, this is not a big problem. If the weather permits, the controller would just warn the inbound plane about the ILS system and would clear them in for a visual approach if they had ILS issues. But on that day, flight 2510 was on the approach control frequency, and the tower controller could not talk to the crew of flight 2510. The tower controller asked the approach controller to hand flight 2510 off to him, but the approach controller was never told about the 737 in the critical area. Making matters worse, the controllers were not aware of an instance where stopping a plane in the critical area messed up the ILS signal. Thus, flight 2510 was not warned about the ILS issue. The approach controller was not interviewed, so we don't know what exactly happened there. Looking back at what happened to flight 2510, we had a busy first officer who was busy reprogramming the computers for the new approach. This meant that he wasn't paying attention to the instruments, and so did not notice that the ILS indicator showed that they were well below the glide slope, by a lot. As all of this happened, a 737 that was taxiing too slowly stopped in the critical area of an ILS antenna, and that messed with the ILS system. Flight 2510 was on another frequency, and so the controller could not warn them about the ILS system. Add to that the controller's wrong beliefs, and now you had a situation where Flight 2510 was off the glide slope by a lot. After this, the captain messed up the go-around procedure, which caused the alpha floor protection to kick in. If you're an Airbus pilot, I would love to know what you think would have happened had the alpha floor protection not kicked in. They were at about 1500 feet at 121 knots, close to a stall. Do you think this would have ended badly? Also, if anyone from Airbus is watching, good job. This video brings us back to a few questions I asked you in previous videos. In the SmartLinks 9001 video, I asked you about the amount of automation that you wanted in a plane. Some of you wanted no automation, and some wanted a lot. In the Air Canada 621 video, I asked you if a pilot should completely trust his or her plane. The responses were varied. Now I'm asking you those very same questions again. Has this video changed your view in any way? In my opinion, there's no right answer. Pilots just have to make that decision on the fly. For example, if you're a pilot that trusts your plane 100%, you may have saved Air Canada Flight 621, but in this case, your trust would have sent you astray. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.